sandwich, that great football team. We see the Pittsburgh Steelers. We need to have it, not only a team. Go out and get them Steelers.
Yes, hello and welcome to episode 56 of the UK Steelers podcast. You're joined as always by me, Simon Winstanley, and the three co-hosts, Rich Cetrone, Dave Hart and Gavin Marshall. And the Steelers make it to 2-0 after a, a slightly shaky fourth quarter against the Broncos at Mile High. But we're there, we're at 2-0. How are you doing, guys?
Not too bad. Just a shaky fourth quarter, was it?
Well, a shaky second half, I suppose you could say, but the fourth quarter was where it kind of was really squeaky butt time, especially that last drive. We'll get onto all that. I've promised today that I'm going to try and get the negative stuff out the way, because I feel like if you listen to last week's show, maybe I was slightly too pessimistic, although I don't know. I mean, you'd be the judge of that. Maybe some of what I said has been backed up this week, and we'll let Gav decide.
I mean, it's not like we're playing characters, right? We've not like assigned you to be Mr. Negatory and me to be Mr. Positive. It's just like this is how we sort of fit.
How we are, yeah. I'm just a very pessimistic kind of guy. we might need Rich and Dave to kind of step in and separate us this week, play referee.
Hold me back.
So, I don't know, we can dive into it if you want. I mean, I suppose we better do that because we've got, obviously, the Texan game to talk about as well. So do you want me to just go on my diatribe first? Is that okay with you guys?
Go on.
Sure.
Okay, so I just kind of want to lay out a few thoughts, and I want to just specify as well that I feel like you've kind of got away with this a bit, Gav, because normally what I do is I go on like my notes app through the game and after the game and sort of jot down some of my early thoughts about the game when I first see it. But this week, I actually managed to delete it for the first time by accident, so I lost the entire podcast, like, notes and thread. And had to redo it today. So I feel like in doing that, I kind of lost some of the heat. You know, I didn't feel as angry about it as I did after the game ended.
You saw it in the cold light of day, maybe with less, more sober eyes?
Yeah, a little bit. I kind of more analytical eyes. I feel like I looked more at the kind of the reasons why. But anyway, so a few thoughts on kind of the issues that I had. How do we get kind of... to a point in the first half of this game where I thought we were going to just dominate, right? To the point where I tweeted out from the Twitter account that it's going to be one of those days, and I had like a fun little dancey gif, and I was really worried I was going to be on Old Takes Exposed, which I almost was, because I tweeted out we need to get Benny Snell in this game, and then he fumbled like on the next play, so more Nostradamus shit from me. But how they end up do we end up fighting for our lives to win it right at the buzzer by stopping Jeff Driscoll driving down the field again to win the game, a backup quarterback who, you know, for large portions of the game was without his top two wide receivers, you know, different parts of the game. The second half just saw too many mistakes and penalties, some of which I thought were harsh, right? I felt like the Steelers were maybe hard done by. I don't think that's homerish to say this week. I think there were some penalties that were a little bit iffy in that game. But we were awful on third downs. We were 2-for-11 on third downs. And we couldn't keep the offense on the field. We kept finding ourselves in third and long thanks to awful first and second down play calling, which I complained about last week, Gavin. You called me a moron for bringing it up.
Moron's a strong word. Curmudgeon, I think.
You know, the defense was gassed, and it began allowing more and more plays. Third and longs were a struggle. And I think it's great that we got the win, but what concerns me is that some of these problems last week were against a really poor Giants team, right? And then this week we're against what I think is a slightly better Broncos team. And we got taken right to the wire. And next week we play a Texans team that I personally think is slightly better than that. You know, so where is the line drawn? What's the next logical step? And I kind of finished my diatribe by writing down three key stats that I thought explained why we almost lost this game. You know, which in itself sounds pessimistic because we won, right? But the three key reasons I think we almost lost this game could be summed up in three stats, right? The one that I already mentioned, we went 16% on third down conversions, right? Awful. We actually lost the time of possession battle despite clearly being better on both sides of the ball, which I think was clear, right? I think our offense and our defense were better than the Broncos, but we managed to somehow lose the time of possession. And we had 10 penalties to Denver's 4. And I think those things combined led to the situation we found ourselves in on the final play of the game. So what are your kind of thoughts on that? Is that unfair, Gav? Are you feeling differently than that?
Again, like, what was your issue with the play calling? Because there were times where they went to the run game, wasn't working, and there's one drive that they just went pass, all incomplete, all no gain, punt.
That's going to happen, though. I mean, that's going to happen. we did not... Where were these drives when we were going pass, pass, pass? That might happen once, I don't know. But it felt, again, like we were very much going to the kind of failed screenplay to two-yard run to third and eight if we're lucky, or third and 12 if we're unlucky, incomplete pass, or pass short of the sticks. You know, that felt like the consistent game thread that we've seen twice now. I don't know. Maybe, Rich, Dave, can one of you kind of put this in a more illustrative way than I'm doing? Because I know, Rich, you at least agreed with my play calling issue, right?
I mean, I've had problems with the play calling in the past. I don't think yesterday was so much play calling. I think a lot of that second half decline was through penalties, through missed assignments. And I think just not only missed assignments, but they're just not able to complete the play the way it was drawn up. Like, our screen right now, our screen game sucks.
Awful. They're awful.
What's going on with that? But they need to shore that up badly. You know, we have two tight ends on the field, you know, that can catch the ball, but just aren't very good blockers. And both of them in the second half had holding penalties. You know, you have Snell's fumble. You have the screw Edmonds screw up on the touchdown, the Fant, which, you know, I know watching Trent Green doesn't know what he's talking about, and, you know, blaming it on Devin Bush. It wasn't Bush's fault. It was Edmonds' fault, you know, and you can even see Hilton yelling
going off at him. Yeah, you can.
Dude, you know, so it's like, I think we have a lot to work on still. We're still not, obviously, I think, going to be the team that we can be, you know, once we get all this stuff together. Because it's a great looking team, but we have some issues that we need to shore up.
You know, some of this sort of second half decline, that some of the credit has to go to the Broncos. It was, you know, Driscoll coming in, you sort of thought, this is the end here. This is where we just take over. And credit to him, he kept a cool head, you know, and pulled off some pretty damn impressive passes, and just sort of, you know, I think there was points for us last season where we sort of, you know, we're sort of struggling, but we're just getting by. And that's sort of what he did, I think. I kind of feel like he's in that sort of domain as a backup that sort of, you know, might possibly win you a game, might not. He's just sort of in that middle area. And yeah, I thought he did really well. And they sort of managed to control the pass rush a little bit. Sort of TJ and Bud went a bit quiet. The whole sort of defensive line a bit quiet at times. Not really getting to the quarterback as much. But yeah, I thought some of the credit has to go to the Broncos for that decline. But there's only one stat that matters to me, and that's 2-0.
Oh, Dave. Yeah. The old romantic.
That's all that matters. A win is a win, no matter how it comes.
It's true. It's definitely true.
Well, that is true, but until the next week is a loss because... You play a better team. I'm going to move off being.
But they didn't play well, and Ben's come out and admitted that they didn't play well. And I think, you know, you've got to think this is the almost like the second preseason game, really, isn't it? And it feels like things are coming together. And I think a lot of it actually on offense came down to Ben and a combination of Ben and the run blocking, because they're not getting it much spaces in the run game. The big run that Connor had. That shouldn't have been a big run. That was poor tackling by the Broncos. They had four like whiff tackles that he didn't even. It was not like he blasted through contact. They just didn't tackle him. So, as far as Ben goes, he's making some good plays, but he's not going through his progressions, and he's not hitting passes with accuracy like we've seen before. He's still being aggressive and he's pushing the ball downfield, but he's kind of forcing it a little bit. And for instance, the fourth and two play. At the time, I just thought it was the wrong decision. But if you watch that play again, he's got Juju wide open on the right, and he just doesn't look at him. Like he watches his first read, stares it down, which is Ebron. Then he tries to escape the pocket, realizes there's nowhere there. Then he looks back to Ebron and tries to force the ball. And He just needed to look at his second read, just look to his right, and he would have had a completion. We had a first down because Juju was past the sticks. Or actually, sorry, it was DJ. So I just think it's been, you know, he's been out for a year. He's not in his rhythm. He's not in his stride yet. And they tried to go, you know, they tried to go to the run. That didn't work. They tried to come back to the pass, and, you know, Johnson had a great game, I thought. But look at the amount of targets he had. But, you know, he dropped a few, and then it just like it just things weren't working out. So I think putting it all on the play calling is...
It's not all on the play calling. I'm not saying it's all. I just find it to be a problem. I just think it lacks any kind of inventiveness. I don't know. I'm going to try and focus on this a little bit more next week as to what my specific problems are with it.
What if?
But it angers me as I'm watching it.
Let's say if your game pass had gone down at half time.
Yeah.
You'd be in a very different space right now.
Yeah.
You'd have been like, this was great. This is amazing.
Yeah.
You know, it's just that they. I don't know. I don't know. Why is it that the Steelers tend to always let teams back into games? They're not a team. You know, they just put up a 50 burger and just. You know, they never kill teams. They just. You know, it's almost like Ben they thrive off the competition element, and that's what drives Ben. And when it gets too comfortable, it's like me when I used to play Tekken. If I was like three bouts up, I'd always like ease off and start doing some creative stuff to try and have some fun, and then I'd end up losing.
Yeah,
it's the same thing. It's like don't quite have that killer instinct, which is gonna, you know, they've got to overcome that if they're gonna make it to the big game. But
it's gonna be interesting when we square up with a quality team. I don't know if this game next week is that, but when we hit like kind of the Broncos game, the Ravens game on the schedule, right, or you know one or two other teams, that'll be when we see where we really are. I think it's difficult right now because how many times we played down to a crap team in the past. So
yeah, but the schedule's favourable this year, let's play to the schedule. Let's not have our best performances against ropey teams.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys feel the same, but it's like Ben has like an alter ego. I call him Bonehead Ben. It's just sort of like you'll do something. You go, why the hell have you just done that? And like you say, maybe there is a bit of a competition thing in the back of his mind. But yeah, he just sort of screws things up for himself, almost seemingly on purpose.
Yeah. I thought Ben. We'll go through kind of the offense first. I thought Ben had a nice game. It wasn't spectacular, like you say. He had those bonehead plays. He missed a few throws low and whatnot. I think there's a couple of ones where you got to give him credit, though. I mean, that pass to DJ, that touchdown on the move was beautiful.
That was beautiful.
Yeah. And he had a few of those, right? I mean, the Claypool pass itself was exciting.
Oh, sweet.
So, you've got to hand it to him. He clearly can move the offense far, far better than when we had him out with Mason. And that's noticeable, right?
Yeah. I mean, well, go on, Rich.
I'm sorry. That's a good example of what my problem with Mason has always been. Like, I don't think Ben played very well. I thought he played okay yesterday. But the difference is he wasn't very accurate. He missed too many passes. But the difference is he's capable of that big play. Yep. That, like you guys said, that pass to DJ, that pass to Claypool. Those were great big plays. We never see that from Rudolph. You very rarely. I can't say never, but you very rarely see that. He doesn't seem capable of that big play. At least he didn't last year. And I think that's the major, that's a major difference with somebody like Ben and Rudolph. And Ben comes up with the big plays a lot of times when you really need it.
Yeah, he's volatile, and I think volatile QBs are better. You know, you hit the playoffs with a volatile QB who's in form, you've got a chance. You know, you hit with one who's got a low ceiling, you're going to be capped. I mean, to talk about the interception, I mean, he had so much time on that, right? The pass protection was great. And live, I thought it was a really misjudged throw into double coverage. We watch it back, actually, Juju had actually got separation. It was a poorly executed throw. He was like off platform, and it kind of the wobble pass, and it was too close to the center field. But if you look, there's a wide open player well short of the sticks that he could have checked down to, but he didn't. He went for the, he was on third and 16, so he went for the first down pass. Mm. So that aggression, that's not coming off. He's not back yet. He's not fully back. He's not Big Ben yet. He's medium sized Ben. I don't know. He's getting back to full, mid season form. But he's still got that mentality that I'm going to make a first down on this difficult. You know, he was technically, there were two players. There was a safety and a corner on Juju there. So, he's not scared to make mistakes. And that's a great commodity.
Oh, definitely, yeah. There were things in this game that worried me far more than Ben. Let's put it that way. that's the nice transition. You're talking about the push that they got there on the pass block. I want to talk a bit about the old line. I thought this was a really bright spot, where last week this was probably the biggest concern that I had leaving the Giants game. Talk a little bit about this. I mean, the stat that's been thrown away all over Twitter this week that I'm sure everyone's seen is that Kevin Dotson didn't allow a single pressure on 40-plus pass plays. Chuck's obviously played at right tackle, and you didn't hear his name a great deal, which was thankful. What do you kind of think of the O-line's play this week? Surprised?
I thought it was good. I thought Filer wasn't quite as good as he had a couple of... He had a whiff of the sack and missed a couple of blocks as well in the run game. And so he'll bounce back. He's still excellent. The whole line's excellent at pass protection. It's just a shame with Banner out, De Castro out, there's no push in the run game. There's no threat there. Pouncey's not as good as he was with that kind of moving blocks, and they're just not creating gaps. So
yeah,
kind of sort of one-dimensional. They know that, you've got to have an amazing run. There's no screen game to talk of. The sweep game, like we saw with the opening play with the botched exchange, that's not... I mean, Denver had more success on their sort of, motions and everything. It just feels like it's like an embryonic offense, and nothing really is settled and easy.
You know what's interesting about the run game yesterday is it seemed like for the longest time, the only time we could get any running room for Connor was on draw plays. Draw plays, he had a lot of room to run. But then late in the fourth quarter, we went to 13 personnel. And you had four runs out of 13 personnel. You had no gain. You had 4 yards. You had 5 yards. You had 59 yards. And I disagree with you a little bit on that 59-yard run, Gavin. I think there was a nice hole there for him to hit. He did run by some guys and break some tackles afterwards, but the hole was definitely there. And I think having Derek Watt out there in that 13 personnel is made a big difference, because I mean they were very effective with, besides the last play of the game, which was a no gain out of it, they were very effective besides that. I think as good of receivers as Ebron and McDonald are, man, they just can't block, and you could see it. Watt's a heck of a blocker.
Yeah, well, I wanted to ask this, where is Derek Watt? Why is he
did a nice lead block on that play Richard's talking about, the long run. He did do a nice lead block.
Oh yeah, I've no doubt that he's a fantastic fullback. My problem is he's not being used enough, right? I mean, why are we not seeing what we saw out of Roosevelt Nix when he was healthy last year? Because to me that would be the perfect opportunity to kind of get this run game going again.
I think Banner was... that was the thing. I think you're going to line up some tight ends on the same side, the right side, with Banner there, and they were going to get some big holes. And him going down, that's kind of... They're doing a lot of McDonald and Ebron next to each other on that right side, and with mixed success.
Yeah, you know what else was cool about that run? When Connor's running down the field, there were two guys down there running, not exactly with him, but in his area, trying to find more guys to block and help him. Claypool was one of them. Do you know who was basically running right next to him?
Nice. No, I didn't see that.
You guys don't remember?
No, who is it?
Dotson. Freaking Dotson.
Oh, yeah.
Wide receiver down the field. It was awesome. I guarantee that one play, he's now the guy in Pittsburgh. Like, Pittsburgh people love that kind of effort. They love it.
I saw him running down the field with Ben on an earlier one when Ben sort of took off to run. I saw him sort of going step to step with him. They kind of have the same foot speed, so...
Hey, watch that. Just watch that play again, Rich, and watch number 99 of the Broncos, and tell me that he isn't fully... He's trying 100% to try and tackle Connor there, because he breaks down. He's got the tackle at about 2 yards past the line of game, and he just does not move. He just kind of gives up on the play. If I was in the Broncos practice facility this week, I would be shining my laser pen on that guy, going, "What are you doing here on that play?"
Oh, you know that's what's going to happen for sure.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it was great. It was nice to see Connor break a big one like that. It was great.
Yeah,
I enjoyed it. Yeah. He deserves it.
You can't
fault him for poor tackling. But yeah, but it was a nice lead block through Watt. You're right.
That's all I want. I just want to see Watt on the field a bit. I mean, we're not paying him $3 million to play in special teams, right? So. I don't know. Tomlin came out actually and said that, listen, we use the fullback to differing amounts depending on the opposition, which, I think maybe he's just saying to placate the fans, but I don't know. I want to see what can do a little bit in the run game, and I want to see what Connor can do with his help as well, especially against teams where we're trying to grind the clock down, which is theoretically what we should have been doing as soon as the second half started.
Connor's ball security is solid, man.
Yes,
you see him. The way he, I think we were chatting on the on, live during the game. There was one, he went for like 10 yards and he had his both hands on the ball. I mean, try running for 10 yards with like that with no arm movement. I mean, he generated some serious bursts like that. And it's just, when we see what happened with Snell, maybe we'll get onto him in a minute. You just think, you really, you know, ball security from your back is one of the main things you want. And he brings that.
Yeah, well, that was the next thing I was going to say with Snell. I mean, this worries me now because that's 2 weeks in a row he's fumbled now, right? And, you know, I'm kind of championing the Snell train like Dave would be last year, saying get him
well,
out Dave, there.
Dave's prediction was... I know. Oh, it's your prediction. Your prediction was Snell 2 TDs,
yeah,
150 yards. Sorry, Dave. I was throwing you under the bus.
I did kind of say that when I thought James Conner like might be a little bit limited, and he didn't turn out to be. So that was just a disaster from the start. But
just throwing that out there for the reverse Simon trumpet that I'm sure we're going to get.
I can't get my head around it with Snell, you know, because he's such a hard runner, and when he's got his head down, he can collide with four guys, and the ball don't budge. But then one guy tackles him and he's got arms looser than a floozy's knickers. You know, he's just going everywhere. I can't get my head around it. Is it a mechanical thing? Is it a mental thing? What's going on?
Sorry, Rich.
It's mechanics. I didn't mention this last week, but when I was watching the game with my son against the Giants, he's running with the ball and it's low and loose, and I'm yelling at the TV, tuck the ball, Snell, tuck the ball, and bam, fumble. And my son goes, how did you know that? I go, he's not high and tight. If you have that ball with one hand, you got to be high and tight, or else you risk fumbling it.
Like your pants, high and tight, man.
Yeah, I didn't know what we're talking about there. If we were still on the loose floozies knickers or the Benny Snell football, to be honest, caught me by surprise. I assume Snell's going to sit for a couple of weeks, to be honest, at this point. Tomlin's not going to take this lightly, I think. As long as James Conner's up, we're not going to see a great deal of Snell for a couple of weeks.
Yet to see any McFarlane.
Yeah, I wanted to mention that. Dave, when are we going to see McFarlane, your boy?
Well, he suited up, didn't he? He had a helmet, but nothing. I don't know if he had special teams snaps at all. I don't know if he had anything. I don't even know if he saw got on the field.
I didn't track him to that extent. Gav, we'll go to you for our relevant special teams correspondent.
No, I didn't see him on special teams. It doesn't mean he didn't play any. I didn't see him. He didn't make any significant plays.
With these fumbles, maybe we'll start seeing a little bit of him, seeing what he can do.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah, but at least just to kind of get a look at him, you know. I thought we might get that this week, at least for a couple of plays.
It might inject a bit of pace into the run game. You never know.
Yeah, absolutely.
How discouraging is it that Jalen Samuels, who really doesn't have a lot to offer this team, I just don't see it, is getting more opportunities than McFarlane? I mean, I would think that he's having trouble grasping the system. I don't know what else it could be.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it was lucky for Samuels that was judged an incompletion rather than a fumble near the goal line. I mean, that could have been a disaster at that point in the game.
Mm. I thought Samuels was going to be a little bit more involved with these gadget plays that we expected to see. And
we haven't seen any. Hopefully that will develop. I just still think it's his embryonic, you know, after quarter pole of the season, we'll know where we are a bit more with this.
Yeah,
I think. Things will form. But I enjoyed, I don't know if you're going to move on, but Ebron, we were talking about tight ends. It's nice to see him getting more involved in the passing game, getting some targets over the middle.
Yeah.
That's, you know, okay, they didn't all work out and it was, you know, what was it, five targets, three receptions, for 43 yards. But there's potential there. Definitely. I can see his role in this offense.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you just want to get him involved a little bit more. Ben said that he will, but... you know, one completion to three. We'll see five next week, hopefully. We'll roll from there. But, you know, he's a different kind of cat than what we have on this offense. So the body shape and what he brings athletically. So, yeah, I hope we see more of him next week. Before we move on to the kind of the skill, we've talked about the running backs already, but just on the O-line, I wanted to get your thoughts, Gav, on this. I'm hearing a lot of, like, what would we do next week? Because David DeCastro is going to be back. So there's kind of three options from what I can see, and I think it's pretty clear what the Steelers will do, but I want to know what you would do. Would you have the current line set up as it is, but just swap out Dotson for David DeCastro? Or would you move Dotson over to where Filer is and move Filer to right tackle? Or would you take Filer out altogether and keep Chucks at right tackle?
I think the threat in the Texans rush is up the middle with Watt. I'm not particularly worried about what's going on outside. They got Merciless and some other just a guy right outside. So I would want to shore up that middle, and that shoring up the middle for me would be sitting Dotson or just using Dotson to spell De Castro, who's coming back, and keeping Fowler exactly where he is.
Okay.
Is that what would you do?
Yeah, well, you were better than this than at me, and I would agree. I think that's the conservative and probably the smart play. But yeah, I wouldn't take Fowler out. I'm not a fan of that. I mean, the guy wants to stay on the field, right? But also, you've got to keep David.
Who's Kennedy. Saying take Fowler out just because he had a bad game?
No. Not so much take Fowler out because he had a bad game, but I think it was just, you know, it was an option if you wanted to move Dotson over to where he is and you didn't want to take Chucks out.
Are people saying that?
No, it's not a prevailing opinion. I just saw it. Okay. Someone mentioned it.
Okay. That's a crazy take, man. Fowler's the best player on this line at the moment.
Oh, that was clearly the the least likely option. It was just like something that someone threw out there of the three things that you could do with mixing this line up now that David DeCastro's right. back. But
yeah, I mean, it's great. I mean, Dotson, yeah, was solid. And that is, you know, great.
Yeah, I think that was the key behind it, right? It was, do you want to keep Dotson on the field after how he's played? But
let's not push our luck, you know. If DeCastro's back, he's the guy. He's the man in town. So let's roll with DeCastro.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think DeCastro offers more in a run game at this point.
Yeah, and Chucks, we've not mentioned him a great deal. What do you think?
Well, that says a lot, right?
Yeah,
that says a lot that we didn't mention Chucks. Didn't really notice him, so he did his job without, you know, peril. Yeah. So I thought he was fine, just fine.
Perfectly said. Okay, good for those two guys. I think that's given me a lot more confidence than I had last week in the O-line. Wide receivers we've hit on a lot already, really. I mean, Claypool continues to impress, as I said that he would before the season. I was waiting for some kind of trumpet thing that Gav was going
to... Oh, do you mean it? But I was actually going to congratulate Dave, because Dave predicted two TDs for Claypool, so he was close.
I know, but you did this last week, congratulating Dave for things he didn't get right.
Yeah, but he did. And actually, Rich was pretty close as well, because he went 300 yards for Ben and three TDs, and obviously it was 311 yards, two TDs.
That was closer. Although I don't know if
we get
that
the
was
almost
goal,
there award.
Yeah.
Oh, don't start with the pink star, guys. Jeez.
Participation award.
Participation trophy.
No, I don't know, Gav. I was trying to set that up because I didn't know if you'd actually gone away and done it. But I was touting my own ability at draft scouting during the game. Much to your chagrin.
I was cursing on that, like, you know, when they kneel down at the end. Mm. I was cursing. I thought I could give it to Chase, just let him get one more, and I won this. I've got one right.
You were actually live tracking that, were you?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Well, I'm going to get the week three right. We're going to get to that later on, but I've got one. I've got a nailed on one. You're going to be amazed.
But what are we talking about, Claypool? I mean, he's got special teams tackles all over the place. He's playing in the jet sweep role. Obviously, the touchdown. I think he's got potential to be the most genuine, keep them honest with the first down deep shot player ever in this offense. He could be, I mean, better than Bryant, better than Wallace. I think he could be the man. Like he's had 43 offensive snaps in two games for a rookie with what he's done in the amount of targets. I mean, it's just awesome. Anyone want to disagree with me about that?
Oh, no.
Can't disagree with you.
No. In recent years, yeah, I'd agree with you. But you know what that reminds me? Did you guys watch the halftime show with Boomer Esiason, Sims, Cowher, Burleson, Nate Burleson? Did you guys watch that? Were you able to watch that?
Yeah.
Well, Burleson was talking about the Steelers' defense and how talented they are, and he's saying these guys are as talented as the Steel Curtain. And Boomer Esiason goes, "Whoa, whoa!" He throws his hand out and goes, "Whoa!" He goes, "Do you know how many Hall of Famers on that team?" And Burleson's like, "Yeah." And then they cut the commercial, but you could see them kind of like going at it a little bit. It was kind of funny.
I was actually going to get into that with you later. I was going to ask you about that, but maybe you've just you've shown your colors, but. So okay, so who do you think you said in recent times who's a better deep threat than what Claypool could become? Stallworth, yeah.
Yeah, I mean because we have a full body of work from Stallworth, right? And it's the same thing. It's nothing against Claypool. And it's nothing against this defense. I love this defense, you know. But you have a full body of work with the Steel Curtain. You have what six Hall of Famers? I mean, I'm just guessing off the top of my head. There might even be more. I'm not sure. Or maybe it's five. But, you have they've done their thing, and this defense hasn't yet. But, I mean, you got to go a long, long ways. I mean, I think in any defense in the NFL to outdo that still current defense.
Sure. Okay. Well, let's hope we get there.
Yeah, I would love it. That'd be awesome.
Well, they're on track to break the set record, apparently. Although I'm trying to play that down a little. I don't like that stat.
Would they keep track back then of sacks?
Yeah. Has anyone ever gone back and counted? I know that sounds silly. Surely that must be possible.
I know, right? That would be really cool. They should do that.
That's a job for you, Rich, next off season.
All right, I'll get on it, son.
Not now.
As I do this podcast, I'm doing that right now.
What I wanted to ask you guys about Claypool was, do you think this guy sees the field more than James Washington, like, by the time we get to the middle of the season or the end of the season?
Yeah, it feels like Washington's becoming the forgotten man, and it's a shame. Do you think Washington could become, I was thinking, is he going to fill that kind of Hines Ward role of just, like, nasty man of the sort of receiver core where he's just beating people up and just getting these hard yards and just... Because when he first came in, he was kind of the deep threat. I'm not sure that that's his best.
Yeah.
I think he's kind of developing into this kind of combative catch, physical receiver specialist.
Well, I was going to say actually that he's vying for a bowling ball award from me. He's making a good case for it. No, he's making a great case. After that touchdown, he was on third quarter against the Giants, where he just battled, and it's like an immaculate extension. Have we got a title for it?
Immaculate. We already have one of them. We can't have another.
Immaculate battle or something. I don't know. It was beautiful though. But no, he's up there. He's as you say, he's massively physical, and I like it. Yeah. I mean,
if you're
more
a 5'11" waif cornerback, nickelback. You don't want to go up against that guy. I mean, he's jacked. Nah. He's tough.
Yeah.
It's just hard, isn't it, to get all four of these dudes on the field at the same time?
I can't remember as a diverse receiver core for a while. Help me out here, Rich. It's verging on Patriots, like with the kind of speciality levels. Or like, you know, the basketball team roles they've got going on here. This is exciting. I'm genuinely excited. And it's like they haven't got a number one. They've got three twos and a deep threat. I mean, it's awesome.
Well, speaking of number one, can we talk about DJ a little bit? Because I feel like he's his own worst enemy, because he simultaneously looked like the best player on the field and the worst player on the field during this game. I mean, the guy is like otherworldly in his shiftiness. I mean, I didn't even know he had this level in him, but I mean, that punt return, not even the one that he took for the touchdown that was called back, but you know, the one where he kind of made it nearly to halfway line, right, where he kind of went backwards. You know, you always get those guys, right, in the NFL that are insanely shifty, but it never amounts to anything. They kind of do all this crazy stuff in the backfield, like they play Madden, but end up going for like 3 yards. He's like that, but he actually gains yards.
Like, yeah, he juked the hell out of that guy.
It's insane. Like, the guy was like just bouncing around the field. Like, you never. On one of the punt returns, he ran into his own player and then still managed to take it for 30 yards. Like, I've never seen anything like it. But at the same time, he's got to stop with these like mental errors. You know, we've seen drops and you know, the fumble as well.
You're seeing the difficult spinning catches. I mean, if he can do those where he's got no time to think, he just needs to settle down. But again, it's you know, settling down with Ben. He's trying hard. He wants to impress. He wants to be number one. I think he can be.
Is he? Because I've been seeing hot takes this week that he's the number one receiver on this offense, that Ben's focusing on him and that he wants to get to him the majority.
Well, the target share would suggest
the
he
target
is.
Share and the yards would suggest so, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you reckon DJ was giving Cam Sutton the evil eye after that return? he threw his hands up like a schoolboy who was going, "I didn't touch it, wasn't me."
I felt bad for him that he didn't get credited with that punt return touchdown, because in reality, that I don't think that block really made a great deal of difference, and it was one of the best. It was one of the best, man.
You watched that. There's about five or six of those on most returns. Yeah. It wasn't a clear-cut one. It was just the kind of torpedo guy, but anyway.
It would have hurt a lot more if we didn't score a touchdown on the next play, let me tell you. Yeah, so Ben spread it around a lot. 9 plays caught passes, right? Juju had, what was it, 8 completions, I think. So, you know, he's 87. Still up there. So, you know, I'm glad we spend this ball around. We've already mentioned Ebron took in 3 grabs. Vance McDonald was out there and got 1 as well. So, yeah, I mean, it's good, right, to spread the ball around a lot. And I think we said this last week, that we're not focusing too much on one guy. And that is encouraging for me. I think we just clean up a bit of these accuracy issues and some of these mental errors, and the offense should be ticking along fairly nicely.
Yeah, and Juju's becoming like the wise head, the old greybeard of the offense. But, you know, stuff going on, isn't he? He's in the right place, right time all the time.
I just hope we keep him. I know we spoke about this ad nauseum, but dear God, we got to keep Juju, man. I know it's looking. I know Rich disagrees with this, but I still think it's looking likely he goes at the end of the season. But I hope he doesn't, man. Some of the stuff he brings is just, even outside of his regular, you know, wide receiver play, just some of the heady, you know, plays that he makes.
Yeah. Well, I've read up on some more on this salary cap, you know, and they've decided that. With the players' union, that the lowest it can be next year is $175 million. And if it's $175 million, we're screwed. Our team will be gutted. I mean, Hilton's gone, Williams is gone, Dupree's gone, Juju's gone, Connor's gone, Vinland Wave is gone, Fowler's gone. You know, we're just going to get completely decimated. I mean, this year it's $198 million and we're struggling. But there is talk also that, you know, it could be as high as $200 million. But what really may ultimately do us in is this pandemic. You know, the owners aren't going to make the amount of money that they should have. And I wouldn't be surprised if they do end up having a cap of 175. And that would really suck. I'm trying to concentrate on this season.
Yeah.
Because we have such a great chance at a Super Bowl. But I can't help it all. You know, I can't help thinking about it, though. It just sucks so bad that we could lose a good portion of these players. And Hilton would be a huge loss besides the three. I mean, they blitzed him 17 times Sunday. I mean, that guy is everywhere on the field because they're mostly playing nickel these days, and he's everywhere on the field. The guy's really turned into a great corner. So,
I was going to say, he reminded me of the agent from The Matrix, man. Like, you think you've got an opening. Suddenly, he, like, appears out of nowhere and, like, blows you up. I mean, it sounds like we're moving on to the defense. But, yeah, Hilton was my MVP of the game, man. I mean,
just
unbelievable.
Me too.
What did he get? 8 tackles and a sack and, like, just – setting the edge in the run game. And
did you see the play where they tried to run a pick play on him? They actually tried to block him before the ball was completed, and he just sidestepped it and made the tackle, and they started pointing at the guy like, no.
he was destroying the screen games he was in, and he was great in coverage. Like, in the fourth quarter, he was breaking up plays. It's just awesome.
Yeah.
It's another guy I hope we can keep, but there's so many of them, right? But, you know, he's one that we could maybe. I mean, maybe wouldn't cost quite as much as some of the other dudes, but, yeah.
He's going to make a lot of money, guys.
You think how much?
Yeah, he'll be up there, man. He'll be one of the highest paid number 3 corners in the league, if not the highest.
Yep.
Maybe they franchise him.
Yeah, maybe. That would actually be a good move, I would think.
But would he not be franchised under the cornerback tag, though? Like, is there a specific one for nickel?
Yeah, that's what I wonder. Mm-hmm. If it's a difference between a nickel corner
I'd be surprised. I don't think you'd be able to franchise tag a player like him. But
surely you can do it like how they did with Bud, where you just sort of class him as something that's nowhere near what his position at all.
It's a long snapper.
Yeah.
talking about the defense, we'll talk about my MVP. And Hilton was absolutely fantastic, probably was the MVP. But I just wanted to give a shout-out to Tyson Alualu, who, I mean, dude, what a free agent pickup this was. You know, when he first came in, we kind of thought, oh, okay, you know, nice depth piece to the D-line. And then, you know, Hargrave goes and we're all panicking the draft about picking up Bravi and Roy. And then all of a sudden, Tyson Alualu steps in, and the dude is, like, legit. I don't know where he's come from or how this has suddenly happened, but he's, like, a legitimate weapon on that D-line, right? He's just, you know, doing more than I ever anticipated out of him. So I think you got to give a shout-out to him.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there was one awesome play on the inside zone, you know, the stretch play, which a couple of years ago used to give Steelers trouble. And they've solved it, man. They're all over that. They're just in the backfield blowing things up. They're not allowing the cutback guy, you know, whether it's Watt just blowing something, you know, the guy that's trying to make the cutback block or Alu in this case. Just moving around. And I wonder if this is kind of with the Ravens in mind and that running game and what the kind of things they're doing. They need to kind of – you can't have that space eater like you would have done before, like Casey Hammond or whatever. You need Alu Alu, someone like that that can move a bit. So maybe it's a tactical thing to try and solve Lamar Jackson.
Yeah, quite possibly. The deep front in general kept up. I think we could probably skip them every week now at this point. I mean, they're so legit. TJ gets AFC Defensive Player of the Week, you know, and the same as.
Yeah, well, this is what I wanted to ask Rich. I mean, is this front, like the line and the outside linebackers? I mean, I'm almost all with Burleson. I mean, is this the greatest ever Steelers front? But you're going to tell me I'm being an idiot, Rich.
Well, I mean, we've had some great ones. You know, that team, what year was it, with Polamalu, where we had Casey Hampton, Aaron Smith, Dave's guy out there. And our linebackers were Harrison and Woodley. I mean, Ferrier in there. That was a great one, too. I mean, it's tough because we've had such a history of great defenses. But these guys are right there. I mean – or they appear like they're in that direction. Watt looks like a freaking superstar. The guy's going to probably – what do you think he's going to command? What, 35? Oh,
no? It's terrifying.
Oh, it is.
He's going to get quarterback money.
Yeah. Yeah, 35, 40 million. I would not be shocked.
Yeah. I mean, did you see the – he pulled off like an Aikido move at one point. Like, wait, they were double teaming. He kind of controlled one guy, got outside of him and pushed him into the other guy. On an inside zone, and then caught down Freeman from behind, who was like running away from him. It was just like, how the, this is like Superman here, like the Hulk smash, and then turns into Spider Man. It's just like, what the hell's going on here? And then he comes back with a serious dip in the next play, gets under his blocker, and then gets a sack. I mean, it's just like the guy's just playing a different game to everyone else. It's just insane.
Yeah.
He moved to ninth in overall Steelers all-time sacks, obviously with the caveat that they didn't track them, as Rich rightly points out. When did he start tracking them? Do we know?
80s, was it?
Early 80s, I believe.
Yeah, okay. So, you know, he's ticking up there. I think he's like nearly like three sacks away from being halfway to the top, which is James Harrison. So, yeah. I think he's well on his way. He's on about 37. I think James Harrison's on about 80, low 80s.
But I mean, what a front, because you've got Cam and then you've got Tuitt as well, who's quietly, he's doing some things. He's not getting noticed, but Tuitt, I mean, he had a shed those blocker moment of just like, get off me. Just get out of me. just gets rid of the guy. Judy was wide open for a first down. He just beats double team and just gets pressure on the passer. And then again on the play where Luck was injured. Obviously it was Watt was kind of, you know, did the near sack and then
Dupree
forced a fumble. But it was actually Tuitt that got three of his blockers and flushed Locke out from the pocket. So really, that was thanks to Tuitt, that whole play. And he's doing some things in there. Maybe not the flashy plays, but he's doing some serious work.
Yeah. It's kind of how Minka's been playing. Minka's actually been doing some things that you just aren't noticeable, but he's making a heck of a difference out there. He's just not making the splash plays like he did last year. But he, you know, he covered for a couple people yesterday and broke up some passes and saved their butts.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he missed one tackle that I remember, but I mean, I think he's one of those guys right now that's playing well, but it's just not really noticeable.
Yeah, he's a solid tackler when he's one-on-one. I can't remember the guy was ready. I mean, he was, you know, it was like a breaking run, right? It was just him on the runner. Was it? I can't remember who it was now, but it was like one-on-one in the hole, and the guy had like 10 yards to juke him out, and he tried, and just Minka was all over it and got him down. So yeah, that was good. But I tell you, who did make some plays, and it's the first time really he's made big plays, was Edmonds. And not all of them were good, but he's made big plays, right?
He's a problem back there.
He is an issue.
He's a problem.
But he had the great pass breakup, saving. And obviously, he had the sack at the end, but that was kind of there were three guys wide open. I think that was more down on Driscoll than
that
anything.
Was Mike Hilton's sack, dude. By the way, like they motioned out the way of Mike Hilton, who was clearly going to end that game and top off the cherry on his cake of that performance, and Edmonds went for it instead, but.
But yeah, but it was the third down, third and three. He had the big he started on the far side, on the other side of the hashes, and just came across, read the quarterback's eyes, and came across and followed a deep completion. So that was probably the biggest play I've ever seen him make. Finally, Edmonds has arrived.
And to his credit, I disagree with that pass interference call on him. I know Trent Green said he hooked him with the left arm. I didn't see it.
I agree.
I didn't see it. I mean, usually what they do, and we've been on the wrong end of this call a couple times already this season, but pretty much every corner in the league or every DB in the league is going to get that arm around there a little bit. And what they've done over the years is if you impede the receiver's progress to the ball, or if you turn the receiver so that he doesn't have as good of an opportunity to catch the ball, they call it then. A lot of the times, though, these guys would just have an arm around it, and just the arm is be there, almost like they're checking them, and they'll let that go. I didn't even think he put his arm around him. He may have just touched him a little bit, but that was such a bad call.
Yeah, I thought the penalties were harsh on us throughout the day, to be honest.
Yeah.
They
wanted the Steelers to let the Broncos back into the game as well.
Yeah, a little bit.
Like someone in NFL head office, like, we need this more of a game, guys. Try and even this out a bit.
Sorry, Rich.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Simon.
No, you go.
I was going to say, I was almost maybe one more bad call, and I was prepared to go on my NFL officials rant. That
we'll save that for another show, shall we?
It'd be quite ugly, trust me.
That's coming up in a future episode.
Yeah. It is.
I wanted to just quickly revisit negative Nelly corner on a couple of these secondary guys, because I got to be honest, the secondary is concerning me a little bit. I don't want to leave thinking that we're all sunshine and rainbows on this. And it's not bad by any means, right? I think this is still one of the better secondaries in the league. I'm just comparing it to a very high standard that was the play last year, right? Which I think is fair to do. I think Hayden looks a step slow to me. I think he's still a great cornerback, don't jump on me, but does anybody else see this? I think he looks a step slower.
He does, and as a result, he's getting a bit handsy.
Yes, yeah. I think he's got great ball skills and instincts, right? And he's a savvy kind of guy, but I worry about him against speedy wide receivers.
Absolutely burned him.
Yes, yeah.
There was a number of occasions where he was getting there way too late. It just, like you say, he's just a step slower, but he's a year older.
Yeah, yeah.
So, it's just
a concern. I think I do want to. I know we've kind of spoke about the 50-50 issue of Edmonds, but I do think Edmonds looked iffy on coverage multiple times. Noah Fant one being the most egregious of them all. And talking about Minka. Now Minka, I judge on a very different level, right? Because Minka is a superstar. We're talking about TJ Watt. Minka's a superstar level safety, right? He's clearly, just watching him on tape, he moves different. He's got different tackling ability. You know, the team relies on him at certain points. You can see when a runner goes through, guys sometimes just stop and let Minka take on the tackle. But there was a couple of situations here where I thought, Minka's not quite up to the level that he was playing at last season. There's the obvious horse collar tackle, which was, just had me up out my seat. Not bad by any means as a performance, but kind of a B-level performance from a guy who you want an A-plus from.
Yeah, it felt like Minka came in and those first four games were absolute A grades, at lights out. And then he's kind of plateaued. And it was kind of, we didn't really talk about it, but because we'd seen those early games. But it's kind of like it's just dropped off a little bit. This season started again with that same plateau. So I'm not worried. I think it will come back. I think those, the cornerback position, that's what I think is probably one of the hardest positions to play. Cornerback, safety, secondary, all that is really tricky, and they missed the preseason, blah blah blah. I'm not worried in the long term. I do think Hayden's on the way down, and maybe was hidden a little bit by Nelson's play and Minka as well. But still a great free agent signing, probably one of the best for a while. So we'll see. It's going to be tested. They're going to be tested more than they have been, and perhaps. That's part, we've not faced great passing attacks yet, have we? So.
Well, that's my concern, and I think that's kind of what I was saying at the start of the show, right, is that we haven't, and we're still getting burnt deep occasionally. And that was a problem years ago, you got to look at the coaching a little bit, and we've got better players now in the back. Yeah,
but you can't defend every deep ball.
There's teams that don't get burned for 40-yard touchdowns every game, so...
Yeah, but then they're giving up all the underneath stuff, and they get killed by 1,000 cuts. So, just...
Defense isn't going to be perfect, no. But it does it concern me giving up this kind of game to Jeff Driscoll? A little bit. A little bit. But anyway, next week's going to be an interesting look at that.
Have you ever seen a backup come in that replicates your starter quite so well as Driscoll? I thought that was. He's not a great quarterback, but he's almost identical to Luck. But with not, like, you know, if you sort of went on Madden and downgraded every skill a little bit, but kept him basically the same player, that was Driscoll. I thought he did a good job.
Yeah, he did.
You know, considering.
Yeah, fair play to Driscoll. Maybe he should have been the one to step in when Ben went down. Special teams, we've got to mention this. A great, much better working coverage this week, I thought, Gav, compared to last week, right? I don't know if you noticed this. Last week was a big issue, but I felt like we just trapped people down really quick. DJ looks dynamic, we spoke about that. Ray again, only got one chance, but took it, you know, again for a decent return. I want to see him get more opportunities, but, you know, it's hard in today's game.
I've got it written here. We have a returner.
Yep.
That's great. I mean, to see, you know, returns taken to almost midfield. You know, if they can start flipping the field, that's a massive advantage. It makes such a difference rather than starting on your own 20 or whatever.
It's exactly the same argument as the punting argument. Exactly the same.
Yeah.
So the only difference being, of course, that you only get like one a game maybe because it's so rare that you get a kick return. But it's exciting, you know, because we've not had that for a long time. Same with DJ, right? If he can, you know, polish up some bits and pieces, this guy's dynamic. So having both of those guys is exciting. And then I've seen some complaints about punting this week. I don't want to go too deep into punting corner, but you know, I'm seeing people moan already online. I think we got to chill out a little bit on this. Everyone's ready to like chuck Colquitt because he shafted one punt. Apparently, I didn't even think it was that bad, to be honest. You watch this.
He knew as soon as he had left his foot it was bad. You saw his reaction to it.
But it wasn't that.
It wasn't awful, but it wasn't good at the same time. Yeah. It was in the Jordan Berry mold of punt, but it wasn't awful. By any stretch of the
imagination. Didn't kill us. It was just, you know, a bit of a shafted punt. Everyone's ready to kick him out. Although, that said, I wouldn't hate a Marquette King sign. You see him tweet out this week. Someone tweeted at him saying...
Yeah, you know, I saw that.
And
yeah.
Marquette King was like, oh, you guys have a good team, though. So, yeah. Anyway, I think that's fine. I'm not too worried about the punting situation.
Can you bring out your free agent punting ranking so we can have a look at where you sit in this?
It's just Marquette King written 10 times. I've been campaigning for this guy for a long time. I can't believe that guy doesn't have a job. Anyway, so that's about it for the Broncos game. We've gone pretty long on that.
Well, I was going to say.
Wait a second.
Whoa!
Yeah.
Whoa!
Hey, whoa. I've got one tiny thing, and then Rich, you can go. I was going to say it was nice to be on the correct end of a safety after last season. Because that was that was grim. We keep getting safeties against us, and it's just embarrassing play, isn't it? But the ignominy of the drop kick after is still hanging your head in shame. Anyway, Rick, what were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say we can't quit on the special teams discussion without mentioning our new special teams ace. You guys didn't see him, Chase Claypool, three tackles.
Yeah. I was going to say Chase and Lane Johnson both doing good work as gunners.
I mean, he was getting down there quick and, man, wrapping these guys up. Really nice special teams day for him.
Definitely.
Yeah, that's all I got.
Yeah, it's great. We're all Claypool fans, I think. The whole Steelers nation.
Yep, and I've claimed him as my own.
I'm sure you can. But yeah,
I didn't like you calling me out on Twitter, by the way, Gav.
Was that a call out? I thought it was just a little poke, harmless fun.
Well,
he's starting to come across as a wide receiver hipster now.
If anyone didn't see this, you know, what did I say? I basically came out and said that, you know, Claypool was mine because I didn't draft him. I mean, I didn't take the card up, but you know, I'm not saying that people in the organization didn't listen to the show. And then Gav was like, oh, you know, he's all of ours. We all liked him.
Did I?
I might have dramatised that a little bit, but...
I think you've dramatised it a little bit. I think I gave you one of these.
Maybe I need to go back and listen to that episode where we talked about Chase Claypool.
No, we were all high on him.
Because I remember being, you know, the Chase Claypool fan in the room, but maybe I'm wrong.
I think you red-starred him. I think that was the difference.
Ah, okay.
And I went for Justin Jefferson.
You were just pink-starring, were you?
Well, he was up there. He was up there. He was in consideration, but I went Justin Jefferson.
You were too busy with you. Yeah, Justin Jefferson. Where's he? Kirk Cousins getting minus one fantasy points.
Okay, yeah. That's
news this week. Not a lot of it, but I just wanted to mention Dan McCullough's apparently released himself.
Did he? I didn't not heard this.
You not seen this? Yeah. No. So Dan McCullough apparently wasn't happy with his 16 grand a week or whatever it is for doing nothing. So opted to release himself from the practice squad contract that he had. I don't know if he's gone anywhere else, but it didn't seem like the issue. Apparently, yeah.
If that contract's still going, I'll happily take that contract.
Cut to Dave being destroyed in training camp imagery.
So, yeah, end of an era with Dan McCullough, I'm afraid.
Oh, that's a shame. I didn't realise that. Oh, well, yeah. Thanks, Dan. Big Dan. Blots the sun. Doesn't do much else.
That's about all the news, really. Anything you want to mention that's kind of not Texans related and not Broncos related?
I thought Justin Herbert looked pretty good.
Yeah.
Surprising.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I can't believe that the Chargers doctor managed to punch through his own quarterbacks long. I mean, maybe it explains why.
Do you reckon that was planned, or was that
what, the puncturing of Tyra Taylor's lung?
No, the whole thing, like, because he didn't even know, like, the coin toss, it was still going to be Tyrod, right?
Yeah.
And then suddenly Herbert's running out there.
Yeah. Apparently, the doctor screwed it up.
It's amazing performance from him to just stick his helmet on, go out, and then take it to the Chiefs like that. I thought it was really encouraging.
I thought it was very Chargers-y not to go for it on that fourth and one, though. It was a horrendous decision, in my opinion, to hand the ball back.
They had to win it with their kicker. It wasn't over, was it?
Yeah, no, definitely not. But I don't know, man. To give the ball back to Patrick Mahomes when he's already got the momentum, and it's crazy to me anyway. I knew he was never getting that ball back.
Sort of as an overall news thing, have you ever known more injuries in 1 week?
Yeah, good point, man. I'm so glad we get to talk about this game rather than some horrific injury to someone important, right?
Yeah, that that's another win for the Steelers.
Yeah.
Major.
Yeah.
Poor old Giants have left Barkley and Nick Bosa and all sorts of big names going down.
49ers are decimated right now. They're not going to make the playoffs. They're in real trouble. Real trouble.
They still won their game, though. No?
Well, I mean, they were playing the Jets. They were lucky in that it was the Jets, right? But yeah, starting running back, the quarterback's not going to be down for long, is he? But yeah, that was an awful game. But yeah, I don't know. I'm just glad we've not got any serious injury issues going into week three, you know, touch wood.
Do you think the everyone's now practicing the curling kick that the Cowboys pulled off?
Oh, yeah, that was fantastic. Yeah, that reminded me of Chris Boswell's old attempt at a Rubana.
Yeah, but I mean, it was just like the Falcons' hands team were just mesmerised.
Yeah, just right? Staring at it.
They couldn't jump on it, couldn't they? They're just like, what is this spinning thing?
I kind of understood the confusion, because it didn't look like it was going to go 10 yards, and if they jumped on it before the 10 yards, they'd be flagged, right?
No, they could have jumped on it. I mean, it's like a live ball. Yeah, they can touch it.
Kicking team.
Is that right? So before the 10 yards are allowed to touch it?
Yeah. The kicking team can't, but the hands on the special teams, you know, the receiving team, they can just grab it straight away. That's why this will never be repeated.
Oh, that is way worse than I thought then. Okay.
Yeah, they're just watching it. There's three of them just standing there going, what is happening? I mean, it's the Bones Fossil, right? I mean, maybe that was all part of the plan. I don't know. Maybe he thought if you do this, they won't know what's happening. So just follow it up and I don't know.
Yeah.
But maybe that's the angle. I mean, because the regular kicks don't work. Do that and just hope that it goes, maybe just boot it a bit harder and spin it and get some random angles on it. I don't know.
Well, I like seeing inventive play like that.
I have actually seen something similar to that, Gavin, where the receiving team just doesn't know the rules for whatever reason. You know, and the ball goes 10 yards. They I don't know what they're thinking, like it's a punt or something. And their kicking team jumps on it, and you know there were guys in position to grab it, and they just didn't. And it's just unbelievable that you make it to that. You've been playing basically. If you get to the NFL, you've probably been playing football your entire life, and you really don't know that rule yet.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
Well, somehow I didn't know that rule, Rich.
NFL, Simon.
And then I should have said it earlier, but I see you brought back the snack helmet.
Yes, the snack helmet. Yeah. Well, I thought, listen, this is the first chance I've had to crack it out, you know. I seem to go well over well on NFL UK's Facebook page. But
so you're going against the snacking fit and no staying fit and snacking light.
Yeah, well, I think that might be the end of the snack helmet for this season because I feel like it like forced me to eat. Like I put a full bag of kettle chips in the top.
What flavour?
Thai sweet chili.
Oh yeah.
And then I put like almost a full bag of, and it was a sharing bag too, of peanut M&Ms in one side, and then what I had left is some spicy nuts on the other side. And like,
it's got quite an impressive capacity. It has.
Well, that's the thing, right? The you know the tub at the top with the where the Thai sweet chili things went, like that didn't even take up half of the bucket. Like I got to put in three bags.
Well, you know, you make it sound like the helmet made you eat this stuff. You put that in the helmet, you know that, right?
Well, no, I understand that, but once it's in the helmet, it ain't going back out the helmet, you know? Whereas if it was in a bag, I maybe would have dipped in and closed the bag. I don't know. Anyway, this is too kebabby for where we are in the show.
It's very kebabby.
Sorry. Jumping the gun.
We get back into LJ Fort making plays for the Ravens.
Yes, anyway, well, yeah, nice move. I want to talk about the teams in the AFC North, actually. We kind of forgot to do that a little bit last week. The Browns and the Bengals was a surprise to me. That was on Thursday night, right? I watched that game. The Browns randomly came out on fire. some people told me to calm down because they were playing the Bengals, but I actually thought the Bengals were going to be better this season, and I thought the Bengals were going to win that game easily. So I don't know what Baker Mayfield ate that morning, but the dude was out there feeling dangerous.
Yeah, he looked better, didn't he?
Yeah, I don't know what was going on. I mean, him and OBJ suddenly hooked up, and all was well in the world with them, but you know, we'll see how long it lasts.
Yeah, I don't trust either of those teams
I guarantee we go 1-1 with the Browns this year, though. I'm telling you right now.
I don't know about that.
I guarantee it.
You can tell that Burrow is a quarterback. You know, they've got their guy there. I think you can see that.
Yeah, yeah. You just worry about the Bengals finding a way to ruin him, but the guy looks legit.
Yeah.
So they just need to sort. I mean, AJ Green looks awful.
Yeah, I noticed you put him on the trade block in the fantasy league.
I mean, AJ Green is a real value pickup.
All 5 points.
and the Ravens, speaking of the game we're about to get to, took it to the Texans. This was on at the same time as that game, so I didn't watch it as closely, but it didn't seem particularly close going into the second half.
No, it seems like the Ravens got their run game going a bit better, and Ingram back on form.
Yeah, just when I dropped him to the bench.
Yep. You know, Jackson passed to 9 different targets. The only person he hasn't passed to is himself, I think. It's getting a bit silly now.
Yeah, this is another thing where I was wrong, I think, because I thought the Ravens were going to regress, and they look pretty good out there. So when's our first Ravens game? Do we know?
That's a good question.
Is it soon?
I can pull that up if you just stall for a minute.
Maybe I don't want to know, to be honest. There's great anxiety in my mind about it already.
Week 7.
Okay, well, Dave, that gives us a bit of time.
At the Ravens.
Okay. Well, maybe someone will die in a porta potty again.
Add to that stat.
They have to be a construction worker. There's nobody else there. anyway, speaking of... I don't know how you can transition from that, to be honest. The Texans. this feels like a really interesting matchup to me. When you think of the Texans, like what comes to mind for me, it's watching Deshaun Watson dance around in the backfield, desperately avoiding pressure and trying to create like an ad hoc play to keep the Texans in the game, right? That he's kind of dancing around, their O-line allows a lot of pressure, he allowed 4 sacks last week. He's doing anything he can to kind of make a play from nothing. Well, the Steelers certainly have the defense to provide that pressure, right? That make life uncomfortable for Watson. We know that this D-line's going to have a day on that O-line, we will certainly hope. But we also, I feel like, have a secondary that's left me a little bit concerned and that I know can get beat. And we're talking about Joe Hayden. They got 2 speedy wide receivers in Will Fuller and Brandon Cooks playing on the outside. So my question to you guys is Watson going to be able to make those plays against this D-line? Is he going to find a way to kind of make that kind of elusive, evasive play that he makes and do it long enough to improvise a win here in week 3? Or do you see our D-line being too much of a swarm for him to escape?
I can't see this his O-line doing anything other than getting beat. So I think it's going to be. I'm going to predict double-digit sacks for the Steelers.
Double-digit sacks.
Yeah, and a bad day for the Texans' offense.
Is that your bold prediction, Gav?
That's my bold prediction. Yeah.
10 sacks is what you're going with.
10. Yeah, double-digit. 10 plus.
Wow, that would be a day. I don't know what to say for that. Rich, what are you thinking about? Because Watson worries me, man. I don't know.
Yeah, it worries me a little bit too. And, you know, the Steelers blitzed, I believe it was 43 times Sunday. And their defense is heavily predicated on getting pressure to the quarterbacks and with the blitz. I think we sacked them the quarterback twice in a non-blitz package, I believe. So it's only a matter of time before you have a combination of a coach and a quarterback that come up with a game plan to exploit that. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if Deshaun Watson is that guy. I don't think their coach is that guy. I don't think he's a very good coach. But it's going to happen. But Deshaun Watson is really a talented quarterback. I don't know. It could be problems. I mean, I think we're going to end up winning the game. Like Gavin says, this offensive line isn't the best. And he doesn't have, you know, he doesn't have Hopkins anymore. And that's a huge loss for them. You know, Fuller's good, but he's no Hopkins. And so, yeah, I think we're going to be okay. I think we're going to beat these guys. But I'm just concerned that we're hanging our hats so much on the blitz, and it may come to the point where it's so, you know, we're so good at it, and we have so good athletes there that no one can stop us. I mean, that's a possibility too, but you know, I don't know. I think we'll be okay against Watson and the Texans.
Yeah, no, I understand. I get what you're saying, because if we don't get that pressure, if someone comes up with a game plan that kind of, you know, negates that blitz a little bit, whether it be, you know, in the screen game or these quick, I mean, we've seen quick passes. I mean, both Daniel Jones and, Drew Locke and then Jeff Driscoll were trying to get the ball out quick, right, to try and negate that blitz, and it didn't work all the time, but on occasions it did. But what worries me with Deshaun Watson is if he's able to evade and move around long enough to let roots develop and let Will Fuller
so much multiple. Sorry, there's just so much multiple pressure. You can't just evade. It's not like you just dodge one rusher and then you're in acres of space.
Yeah, no, I know.
There's like three, four rushers. The interior line guys are just getting rid of their blockers and they're in their face.
What I'm saying is where you see this with, you know, with Jeff Driscoll, right? You get three guys running through on Jeff Driscoll. He's down on the ground. With Deshaun Watson, I feel like I see him every week with three guys in the backfield, and he jukes one guy and spins around another guy, and all of a sudden he's down the sideline, you know, and he's evaded two rushes that have come free, and that can happen.
I think that was true when he had Hopkins, like Rich was saying, to hit, you know, that just knew they were in sync, right? They would both break the same way, and he knew that, you know, Newt could just get beat his marker and get the ball. I don't think that he's in sync yet. He hasn't found his rhythm with his receiver core. He doesn't know, is it Will Fuller, the deep threat? Is it Cooks? I don't think he's settled. He's missing Hopkins, basically. I don't think it was a gamble, wasn't it, to trade away Hopkins and try and make Watson a better overall quarterback by spreading the ball around and reading the whole field. And it might work in the long run, but I think it's too soon, and I can't see it. I just think it's going to be a bit of an easy game for the Steelers. Maybe I shouldn't say that, but that's the way I feel it.
Well, you know, something else about that blitz, if you watch the, especially in the first half, it looked to me like Denver's offensive game plan, at least their running game plan, was set up to exploit the Steelers' blitz, and they actually did. Mm-hmm. If you look at those long runs that Gordon had, every one of those runs were somebody blitzing on the opposite side, and I don't know how, maybe it was blind luck, but they ran the perfect play. Like three times Gordon had long runs and it was like, whoa, what's happening to our defense? Yeah. Well, they were exploiting the blitz and somehow they guessed it right. I don't know if they saw something in the first game in the Steelers formation and they knew what side they might be blitzing on, but they absolutely exploited that. And a better team could possibly do that with the run to set up the pass and to settle that blitz down a little bit, you know, and set the pass up more. So, I mean, that's something to look out for as well.
Vader's disagreeing with you there.
Vader's not happy at all.
He's barking at my son. His eyes are bad. My son's out just barking at him. Jeez, sorry.
This can stay in the picture.
Big Deshaun Watson fan. Dave, what do you think of this matchup?
You know, you were saying earlier that sort of the Texans were the sort of a step up from the Broncos. It's like maybe slightly better. I'm feeling the exact opposite. I'm feeling way more confident in this than I was last week.
Wow.
What have they got in terms of a running game? They've got, David Johnson. Mm. Once you've sort of got that under control, it all falls on Watson's shoulders. And as you guys just been saying, if you can get enough pressure on him, chances are he's not going to be able to either find a receiver, or you're going to bring him down. So I think it's going to be a bit of a walk away sort of game. We're going to run away with this pretty easily, I think. Maybe it's misplaced confidence, but I'm feeling it's going to be a pretty easy week three.
Okay, wow. Well, we'll get onto some score predictions in a minute. Before we do, we're going to see all three Watt brothers on Sunday, right, for the first time on the field.
Yeah.
Who's going to have a bigger day, TJ or JJ?
TJ.
Yeah.
Oh, I knew you'd not say that.
What are the odds of all three Watt touchdown?
Give me
the odds. All three Watts score a touchdown.
Oh, Jesus, man. I mean,
that's pretty slim.
I need a bookmaker because that's a bet I want
to
take.
That's got to be 1,000 to 1. I mean, it's pretty slim that one of them gets a touchdown.
Yeah, I reckon 1,000, I reckon, is pretty short. But you can see it. Didn't they used to give like Watt some carries or some goal line targets? JJ, that is. And then you're looking for a TJ return and a Derek Watt carry. I don't know. Could be a millionaire.
Well, Derek just had a touchdown this week. He made the tackle and he went for the ball, but it went out of bounds. He's pretty quick about it too.
Yeah, could have happened.
So I considered that for my bold prediction.
Oh,
I thought that was way too bold.
That's a huge onion.
It's a fun one.
Well, okay, here's with your bold prediction, Kev. Oh, you've told us yours, haven't you?
Yeah.
Remind everyone.
Just to remind you, I think there's going to be double-digit sacks.
Yeah, that is bold. That's bold. Dave, have you got one lined up?
Again, I've got two.
Which one's the one I'm going to put down on the score sheet to see whether...
Right, well, I'll give you that one first. That there's two interceptions and one forced fumble. So three takeaways altogether. It's not that bold, but it's a prediction. The other prediction was that Ben will do a TikTok dance.
Oh, you see, I like that one more, but... I'd like to see it. But, okay, yeah.
I think Juju will talk into it in the end.
Is that for one player or is that just in total? Bold, really. But,
yeah. It's not very bold, but it was
a bit blasé, that, Dave.
Yeah, sorry, but I thought that the Ben one would make up for it. So I think Juju's going to talk him into doing some sort of TikTok dance, even if he just sort of has a. Does Ben have hips? Even if he moves his hips a little bit. Just something, a shimmy or something.
They're mainly steel at this point, I think. Bits of iron bolted together.
So we need two interceptions and a forced fumble and a TikTok dance from Ben.
That's on top of the 10-plus sacks. Wow, it's going to be a big day.
Yeah, crazy game. Rich, you got a bold prediction lined up?
You know, I couldn't think of anything that I really felt strong about. So I'm just going to go with... No, that wouldn't be bold. If I say J.J. Watt gets held to zero sacks, would that be bold?
Right, something to root for.
Something to root for. Okay, how about Deontay Johnson gets two touchdowns?
Okay.
That's kind of bold, I guess.
Okay, yeah.
Is that a double? Is that a double trouble? So DJ two TDs, J.J. no sacks?
Okay, that'd be bold. That's bold.
That sounds like an onion hanger to me.
Yeah, got to pass the bold test. Okay, you're not going to like this, Gav. I'm going to make myself public enemy number one today.
Is it going to involve one of our players fumbling?
No. This game is going to be decided exactly like this. This game will be decided by a field goal in the last 10 seconds of the game. I'm giving myself 10 seconds because I don't want to be this guy who's like, you know, it's a... as the clock winds down and then, you know, there's 1 second and we get back and we're all arguing about whether that counts next week. So I'm going to say with at least 10 seconds to go in the game, it'll be decided by a field goal by Kamir Farabane, who will score and beat us by under 3 points.
I don't like that prediction.
That's my bold prediction, Gav. Take it or leave it.
So basically you're saying the Steelers are going to lose by a field goal in the last 10 seconds.
Yep.
You are relishing in your role of the spoil monger.
Listen, this has been consistent, Rich, since, you know, you all picked Steelers for the Super Bowl.
Yeah. I think it was only me and Gavin. I don't think Dave did.
Well, Dave picked us to get there. He didn't pick us to win, in fairness, but...
Oh, okay.
Hey, I got to say, me and Rich were the and Dave were the outliers in the world, and now the rest of the world has caught up with us, and people are starting to say that they have. We've gone from dark horses to medium shade horses.
Yeah, but this is what worries me, though. We've played two pretty crummy teams, and now everyone's like, well, the Steelers are going to be a dark horse for the Super Bowl. It's like,
no, don't lie down in front of the hype train, man. You know, it's rolling.
I don't think I had...
Oh really?
I thought Steelers Super Bowl. I think I had Saints and Chiefs.
Oh, sorry.
I had us making the playoffs.
Get off the train.
Yeah, I thought you had the Chiefs, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Maybe I need to go back. Maybe I've just plunged Dave in with the rest of you.
I've ruined your point there. Sorry.
I don't know. I still think 50% of the show thinking the Steelers will win the Super Bowl is like pretty bold. But... anyway.
Anyway.
By the end of the season, Simon, you're going to be referring to me and Gavin as Nostradamus 1 and 2.
I certainly hope so, man. I hope so. And I hope that my bold prediction does not come true this week. But hey, kind of me fired about it.
Why would you pick that? I want a bold prediction to root for. I don't want to be losing the game.
See, this is exactly the problem with people like you. You can't just be, you know, rooting for... Sometimes it's nice to like have a thing to... console you, yeah, if you lose, you know. If we lose and Kami Fairbairn scores the go-ahead field goal, then, you know, I'll be down, but I'll be like, hey, at least I got my whole prediction right.
You're the kind of guy that makes, like, 15 bets so just in case, so that at least one of them will cover all the rest of the losses. You don't win like that, man. You always walk away not winning or losing.
I don't win a bet in any way. I'm not dogging me on that. I've deleted my bet.
Exactly, that's because you do this.
Josh Jacobs upset me greatly this week. Let's put it that way.
Good. He's looking really good. Well, like he's been underrated.
Not good enough to win me £200 by scoring one touchdown. That's useless.
Oh, okay. touchdowns are fleeting.
We'll speak no more of that. Listen, I just think we'll get on to score predictions. I just think that the Texans are 0-2. Right, we're 2-0. They've played Kansas City and Baltimore, which is literally the toughest start out the gate you could possibly imagine. We've played the Giants and the Broncos. They're in desperate need of a win here. We're kind of floating a little bit high on cloud nine. We're due a loss because we haven't played as well as people think we have. The Texans aren't a bad team, even though Dave's going to tell you that they are. Watson is a dangerous quarterback who could punish us and some of the issues that we've shown. This feels like a textbook loss to me. I don't know. I'm calling it Texans 30, Steelers 28. And before anyone slags me off, listen... What do you want me to do? Pick the Steelers to win 16 games? Like, I don't know.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so Steelers lose 28-30.
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to go for a 24-10 win.
24-10? I should say as well, the line right now is Steelers minus 3.5.
That seems quite short to me.
It's actually shortened. It was minus 5 when the schedule was released, but that's shortened, even though, you know, these teams have gone opposite directions.
That seems crazy.
I don't think that's crazy.
3 points. Okay. Well, yeah, you've got it being settled by 3 points.
I mean,
points,
dude, so you're talking about us winning by, what, 14 points in a game where we just scraped past the Broncos last week? I mean, I don't know. Who's the crazy one here?
Well, okay, we'll see. I just think the Texans are a mess, and they don't know what they are, and their defense is in massive regression, and they're coming up against the best defense in the league, and a very potent passing attack, and a below average run attack. But I think the Steelers have got this.
I agree with what you're saying, Gav. But if I'd have come to you last week and said we're going to play Jeff Driscoll for 3.5 quarters coming up against the league's best defense, you know, you'd have said the same thing.
Sure.
And now we're playing Deshaun Watson, so.
Yeah, so I just think the Steelers will raise their game to the level of opposition.
Dave?
I'm going all out, 31-6.
Balls deep, 31-6. Okay. Rich?
31-24.
Oh, yeah. 31s, I like it.
Oh man, listen, eventually someone else is going to pick the Steelers to lose a game. I don't know when it's going to be. I promise I'll do this at least a couple more times this season as well.
Okay. I might pick a better team like the Ravens to beat the Steelers. I'm not a complete, you know, it's not 16-0 every year, but
we only ever lose to like the best teams in the league. Like we're constantly losing to crummy teams.
It's usually either the best or the worst.
Yeah.
That's how it usually goes.
I could see a reality where this game just turns into a feast for the defense and we just win it by far. I can certainly see that in the realm of possibilities and me looking like a fool next week and having to eat crow with you three, but
it's shifting sands. You know, this is early season. Mm-hmm. Nothing is as it seems, and you can't really see into the crystal ball yet. You don't really know who they are yet. So I think this will be where the Steelers stamp their authority on offense.
I hope so. My boy Fairbairn's going to come in for me on this one, though.
Simon, you're kind of like that guy in the movies, like a killer slasher movie where the teenagers come into town and he goes, "Go back! You're all going to die!"
Yeah. Oh, the weird guy that's dressed as like a scarecrow. Okay. Stay on the road.
My eternal pessimism is the only thing that keeps me alive. Okay, anything else to hit on the Texans before we take a visit to the local kebab corner?
I don't know. I don't know what else to say about the Texans. Really, I really don't know who they are. So no. But we've got to make our picks for.
Oh yeah, of course the gauntlet. I forgot about that. All together.
Yeah. So far, 2-0. Si and Rich, who both picked the 49ers this week.
Very nice. Escape with that one.
Yeah, I picked the Packers, so that was it looked a little bit closer at one point, but yeah, they blew them away in the end. And then Dave picked Washington, so that was an L for you there. So currently it's me and Dave on one, Si and Rich on two. So who are you going to go for this week? I've got mine. I'm going to go for the Bucks against who are they playing again? I've forgotten who they're playing.
Broncos.
Yeah, that's it. And I've already blown my Colts pick, so you could take them.
It's going to get to it. I need to start writing these down because there's going to be a point where I forget who I've taken, but there's a lot.
I've got it here, don't worry.
Interesting options this week. You know, the Dolphins are playing the Jags, which is a kind of an interesting opportunity to get rid of one of those.
I'm a little bit cautious after using my Washington, getting rid of one of the lower end ones. So I'm trying to make a bit of space.
That was a ballsy pick, to be fair.
Well, you think you got to save your guarantee, or your pretty much guaranteed ones towards the end, surely? That's the sort of way you got to play it. So I was thinking that way. So I think I'm going to take the Colts over the Jets.
That's where I'd be going if I hadn't already picked the Colts to beat the Jags.
You know, I'm really tempted to say the Jags, but yeah, I think you're right. I think the Colts is the only real smart pick this week. Maybe you could argue the Titans against the Vikings, who look poor. Maybe even the Rams over the Bills.
Feels kinda like the Vikings have got to wake up at some point.
Yeah,
they?
Yeah, exactly. That's what worries me. Yeah, I'll play it safe. I'm going to go Colts.
I don't know if that's safe, though. I mean, it's interdivision game. Those guys always, besides the Patriots, they always beat up on each other, and it's hard to predict. And the Colts aren't as good as I thought they would be, at least not so far. But the Jets are really bad. This is a tough week.
Yeah, it is.
Not even a team.
It is a tough one.
Jets are so bad. I wish I hadn't picked the Cards.
I kind of like the Cards over the Lions, but again, they need to wake up at some point.
Yeah, Cards is another one.
It's holidays back for them. Yeah, we haven't really seen their offense, right? It kind of sort of predicated around.
Eagles will beat the Bengals. You've got to imagine they're 0-2. They need a win.
The Eagles, I'm not sure about the Eagles. I think they're collapsing.
Do you guys see the Chargers and the Chiefs game?
Yeah, what a game.
Wow, you know, everybody's going to be studying the Chargers' defense on that game because they gave Mahomes fits.
Yeah.
I mean, they really should have won that game in the end.
As close to anyone as to stop them, right?
Yeah, they look good, and that's a running game. See, that's what you want to see out of the Steelers. You know, they had that 1-2 punch with Joshua Kelly and Eklund. They looked really good in the running game. Yeah. And Herbert looks great. I'm glad too. I drafted him in my dynasty league in one of my draft picks. Okay, I'm going to go Chargers.
Sorry, Rich, you deserve that.
Somebody has to. I'm not going to toot my own horse. Thank you. I appreciate that. I'll go Chargers against the Panthers.
Chargers, okay.
And who did you pick, Rich?
Chargers to beat the Panthers?
Sorry. I meant Gav. I've done it again.
Bucks,
okay.
Against the Broncos.
So Bucks, Chargers, and Colts to watch, okay.
I think that Bucks defense is going to be too much for the boy Driscoll. It's going to wilt.
Okay. Cool.
Okay. Before we get into Kebab Corner, I noticed on the halftime show you were talking about earlier, Rich, we saw a double trouble of suits being worn with trainers. Wondered if it's a look you've ever pulled off.
Suits with, I'm sorry, what are trainers?
Sneakers.
Oh, sneakers. Sorry.
Oh, wow. I never would have thought to make that correction.
Yeah, I've seen, what's his name? Michael, Strahan. I've seen Strahan do that. There's these shoes out that kind of look like sneakers, but they're kind of supposed to be like a dress shoe. Strahan has worn them. Howie Long has worn them.
If you can go semi-cash, you're all right, aren't you? If you
these were like black tops with white rims, sort of like Converse or something. Both of them were wearing them.
Oh, really? I don't know if I've ever done that as an adult. I know I've done that younger, but I think styles have changed a lot since then. But it's cool. I wouldn't dismiss it. I would try it.
I'm not sure I've got the moxie to pull it off. I think that's I know my limitations. Si, you're a young guy. Could you pull it off?
I don't pull off anything. I've just completely given up with all facets of fashion, and now don't leave the house in anything but a t-shirt and some awful shorts and probably a cap.
Dave, when was the last time you wore a suit?
I my wedding.
Was that the first time you wore a suit as well, or was it a court date?
Funeral. I don't know. I rarely wear them. I like wearing a suit, though. The problem is I fancy myself in a suit, so I get a bit too vain. But
I'm the same as you, man. I get a suit on, I start looking at myself in the mirror and thinking, I could be James Bond.
Yeah. I'm the kind of guy, I'm generally wearing shorts, so I really wanted to wear a shorts suit for my wedding day, but I was told I'd look like Angus Young. Is it Angus Young out of AC/DC?
would you have worn the trainers with that, though? Like the Converse?
I had to give it a good go, man. I had to give it a go. It's got to be done. But yeah, no, you've got to sort of put a suit on now and then, haven't you? You've got to give it a go. I'm not a smartly dressed person generally. I'm sort of I'm a scumbag. But but yeah, but yeah. I fancy myself too much in a suit. I try and avoid wearing it too much.
I like to be able to feel that I could do like a casual suit. You know, if you're just going out for. I don't know, maybe a drink or something. You turn up in jeans and a suit jacket. I can't even pull that off.
Are you one of these guys that like a t-shirt and a suit jacket, one of those sort of ones?
No, I'm not that at
you
all.
Know, I did that a little bit at uni, and I think it did work, but I've put on so much weight since then, it just wouldn't. Mm. Unfortunately.
I sort of stretched to a nice jumper over a shirt. That's about as far as I can go, which is kind of nerdy look, but I feel comfortable in that. I just don't like feeling uncomfortable. That's the thing. You know, I sort of feel like, no matter what you do, you should be ready for some action. And I feel like I'm not ready. I'm not like James Bond. You know, you're not ready for some action in a suit. You've got slick shoes and things are too tight and they're going to rip if you do something. So
those shoes are dangerous, man. The amount of times I nearly get on my arse on like 100%. on like a polished floor. Man, I'm nearly on my arse. That's without the beer.
Right. Do we enter Kebab Corner?
Let's get in there. Let's dive in.
Four large dollars, mate.
Everything on them.
Do you want onions on your set?
I do. Plenty onions.
Well, there's a few things to get to, other than, you know, sneakers with suits. You know, it's early in the season, but it's really exciting to see that there's a front runner out there, and you know, Hermine made a fantastic Battenberg. And her sort of bust rendition of that girl out of, what was it? Out of Black Panther? Was she in Black Panther?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought it was really good. British Bake Off is on the go again. bit of that was an off-air conversation. But the main thing to get to was off-air and on-air last week, we had a bit of a kebab beef.
Oh dear!
I don't know if beef is the right word, because it was other things that were being discussed. Apparently, there's beef between chicken and lamb. I'd like to hear the two arguments, and we can make a final decision on who's the winner, who's the victor.
Are we talking general or just in kebabs?
Kebabs.
So this is like a fundamental kebab corner.
Mm. This is really about what kebab corner is all about. Kebabs.
It's drawing lines in the pavement outside of the kebab shop.
I want to hear the bell ring. Have you got a bell ring? round one. Ding ding.
Well.
So maybe take it in turns for your points. I don't know. Or the two of you just fight it out on air.
Listen, all I was saying last week was that the kebab, when I'm referencing a kebab, right, I'm talking about a thing. It comes in one of those polystyrene boxes, right? It's a big naan. I don't want any of this pitta shite. It's a naan. And it's just a pile of lamb doner meat, right? Now, listen, I understand that there are other things called kebabs, right? You can stick meat on a stick and call it a kebab. But it's not the point, right? I'm talking about, you know, getting a kebab. And I think that's what the heart of this corner is, and I think Dave knows it as well.
Hang on, you're putting it on a naan. You're going internationality cuisine here.
Yeah, what's a naan? The naan's a dipping bread for curry.
No, this is the other problem, right? This is the problem with this. Is why I can't stand living in York, right? For this one reason, because all they do is serve doner on pitta, and it's a disgrace. I mean, pitta isn't even worth, you know, the wheat that it's made out of. It's a joke. They kind of slit it open. It doesn't even have a hole, but they slit it open for some reason, and then you put all the kebab meat in, which it holds none of. And then it just splits open anyway at the bottom, so it's completely pointless. It's the worst constructed thing I've ever seen. You need to put it on a giant naan that's the size of your leg, and that's the only way that should be served.
I didn't know you had such strong feelings on pitta. I'm seeing you in an entirely different light now.
Now, so. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying the pitta, you know, pitta in other usages, fine. If that's what you want to do, that's not my... in the privacy of your own home, if you want to touch a pitta, that's fine by me. But for a kebab, it needs to be on a naan. Otherwise, just get a tray of doner meat.
I understand what you're saying, but the pitta is the benchmark. So, you know, it's like the Andy Dalton of bread packaging for kebabs. Like, if you have anything worse than the pitta, you haven't got a kebab at all. And if you've got, you know, you can go above and beyond the pitta into, you know, flatbreads, rotis, and naans, like you're saying. But I think, you know, most people are introduced, you know, when they start drinking in pubs, their first introduction to a kebab is with the pitta, so I don't really think you can criticise the pitta. It's fundamental to the construction of a kebab.
But that's my point, is that it shouldn't be. I mean, I'm lucky that, you know, where I came from, there's a lot of things wrong with Bolton, in that it's, you know, the UK hub of the coronavirus, and, you know, it's an economically deprived area, and the place is a complete shithole. But of York. All the things wrong with it... No, Bolton. Bolton.
Fair enough, yeah. Okay, yeah, that's true. I thought you were talking about York.
No.
Old York for a second. Old York,
where I'm from.
One of the prettiest towns in... former capital of the United Kingdom, and, you know, one of the prettiest towns in the UK. I'm not sure you could be saying that.
And if you need more information on York, please visit the tourist board at gavinmarshall.gmail.com. No, listen, York's great, but what I'm saying, that's my problem with York, is they don't do a good kebab, whereas Bolton, for all of its other transgressions and issues, is a master. And this is true for a lot of areas around Bolton as well, which is why, you know, I wanted to hear Dave's take on it, because it sounds like maybe he's not had the same experience as me. They have mastered the kebab on naan, and that is the default that it's served. If you order a kebab in Bolton, it's not coming in a pitta unless you go to the wrong place. It's coming in a naan, and it's going to be the size of your leg, and it's going to cost £3.50.
I don't know. Putting it on a naan, man.
Only way. I don't know.
Maybe I'm buying.
This is absolutely insane to me that Dave is even... Are you telling me you've not had a kebab on naan, Dave?
No, I haven't, but...
No, this is...
I don't know. For me, because, well, I'm... Drama.
I feel like I've mentioned this before.
I mean, for me, I'm married to someone from an Indian background, so naan is for one purpose. You know, it's...
Do we want to know?
you couldn't imagine. No, I mean, even Gav's rendition of saying it's for dipping, it ain't for dipping. This thing is for, a naan is for picking up.
Smearing, isn't it?
You're grabbing as much as you can within that naan and eating, stuffing it in your face. It's almost like a utensil.
But what stuff are you putting in it?
Curry and rice.
Right, yeah. We'll just substitute that for doner.
Yeah, but it's you go into cuisine. You're going too. You know, you're being too fusion. Progressive here.
But have you not had one of those kebabs where it's almost like a wrap, and it's, you know, it's wrapped in tin foil and it comes in a cylindrical shape. You know,
yeah,
I want those.
In a naan bread.
Yeah, yeah.
No, but that's not a naan. That's a tortilla.
Yeah, but no, this. Yeah, yeah, but this is a naan bread.
Yeah, I know, but it's a different thing. So there's different ways of packaging a kebab, but that's what I'm saying. Your starting point is the pita bread. So I don't think you can criticize a pita bread. But
it's trash. It's not fit for the service it purposes. I think maybe.
It's like you said, you've got a McDonald's, you've got, you know, but then you've got a Byron Burger, and you've got, you know, a Five Guys, and you've got an In-N-Out. You've got, you know, things that are better than the norm, but the norm.
Yeah, but this is my point, though. That they're not on different levels, right? Because in Bolton, you can buy a kebab on naan for £3.50. That is the basic kebab. You come to York, you spend £6 on a half the size nonsense little pita thing. It's just not comparable. And maybe this is because, you know, I started with the naan, right? And I think a lot of it's to do with the fact that a lot of the takeaways, obviously, in Bolton are being run by Asian families, right? So maybe that's where the naan bread is coming in first and foremost before the pit. I don't know.
They're making a necessary improvement. You know, but, you know, you can't criticise what is a staple. And Dave's question was about meat versus chicken, not about what fancy breads would you like over a pita.
Yeah, we've completely taken this off track because I didn't realise you were so naive to the bread situation, you see.
I'm not naive. I'm willing to see that there's a spectrum here.
There's no spectrum, Gav. There's only one right answer.
I'm not dismissing the pita bread. It's got its place.
But what is the place, though? Just a substandard kebab?
It's not substandard. It's perfectly fine. You know, the question is, do you eat it with a fork or do you pick it up?
That's not a question. No one's asking that.
Everyone's asking that.
This is exactly my point. Only people in London are asking that, Kev.
No, they're not, because everyone's eating them out of a tortilla now. But, but back in the 90s, that was the question.
I bet you're eating your pizza with a knife and fork.
I ate a pizza before the show, and I very heartily rolled it with a pizza roller. So, no, it was sliced. I did slightly burn it, but that was...
I think you rolled it up into a sausage and eaten it.
Yeah, I was confused.
I didn't calzone it.
So you picked up each slice individually and ate it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Guided it in. Maybe folded it slightly to make sure it went in between.
That's fine.
You know.
I don't have a problem with folding it. I like a calzone. You know, I just have an issue with utensils.
The beef was lamb versus chicken. Yeah, because it did seem to be quite an intense... argument.
Yeah, well, likewise, like with the pita, originally I was introduced to after a pub visit, it was lamb. But I realised after a while that chicken was far superior and better quality. Especially if you went for the sheesh, which is cooked on a skewer and then carved. You know, that's a great meal.
We're no longer talking about the same thing.
What?
We're no longer even talking about the same thing, though. This is the problem. Like, yeah, they're both called a kebab, but they're not the same thing. Like, one, you know, fulfills the essence of this corner, and the other is, like, you know, some namby-pamby nonsense that you've bought from...
It's not namby-pamby.
Waitrose.
If you've got two elephant legs next to each other, one lamb, one chicken. What's the difference? And then, as a third way, you've got some skewers, and you've also got some burgers and some chips there, you know? But you've got those two elephant legs. Which way are you going to go? There's no looking down your nose at it. There's no like, oh, well, one's a kebab, the other one's an imposter. That's not.
One's just a chicken wrap.
It's not just a chicken wrap. Dave, you're agreeing.
I'm swaying towards Simon's side of this, but mostly because chicken isn't an option near me. It's whatever mystery meat is in the elephant's leg. And that's it for me. That's all I get.
Do we not have the dual elephant's leg? One of each?
No, not at least not as far as I've seen.
Oh, man.
It's less common, but I've seen it. Yeah.
Oh, wow. How did you live? Were you North London in like the Turkish district? Like Green Lanes around it?
When I lived in London?
Yeah.
When I lived in London, I was in a little village called Teddington. And there's one kebab shop, and that shut before the pubs closed, so I never went in it.
No, that's deep south. Yeah, that doesn't count. You need to be in the north. In the north, we go both ways, chicken and lamb.
I mean, this is coming from a city that eats saveloys.
Yeah, I mean that thing isn't a sausage. That's
you literally cannot improve on a jumbo sausage or a battered jumbo sausage. And they made a saveloy because they weren't happy with that.
No, we go for jelly deals. But anyway, we've lost Rich. Rich is.
What we need to do, right? This is what we need to do. We need to get Rich over here, right? One day. And we need to sit him down.
Taste test. A blind taste test.
Yeah. We need to find a place. I don't know where this magical place is.
The problem is you need to ply him with 10. You know, he doesn't drink. You need to ply him with 10 pints because kebab isn't kebab unless you're drunk.
I don't know. I eat kebab sober.
I do, but they're not the kind we're talking about here.
Yeah, maybe not. But what we need to do, we need to find a magical place that serves like all these things. They serve the naan in pitta and the kebab in naan and pitta, and they serve the chicken and the doner. And we need all these things, and we need to like present them to Rich all at once. He needs to tell us which looks most appealing, and then which tastes best. That's the only way to know for sure.
I think it's fair to say we're undecided at the moment.
You know, hearing about the price you're having to pay, Si, about with kebabs in your humble city of York, it reminds me of a joke that was, I went into a kebab shop, ordered a doner kebab, and they said, that's £20. And I said, sheesh. Yeah. Sorry.
I had a decent joke today. It was... Private Cooper, I didn't see you at camouflage practice. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Any jokes, Rich? any one-liners from across the pond? Oh, dear. Right. On that note, let's wrap this up. We've spoken far too long about kebabs. You've hit an impassioned, coil. Yeah. I wasn't keen on Gav's opinion there. That was offensive.
Wow, jeez, really?
Well, just your fondness of the pitta, because you're the problem, you know. You're the reason we have pitta.
It's not a fondness for pitta. I don't choose pitta over other options. I'm just saying you can't undermine it. It's like it's a fundamental. It's built upon. But, I mean, you've got to know the history of the kebab in the UK, and pitta is fundamental to that.
This is again why we have places like York where you can't find a naan bread for the life of you because people like you just acquiesce to it.
I'm not acquiescing. I would choose for. Sounds like your naan. I'd go for that. I think it's called a dana bread. I'm not quite sure. There's a special Persian bread that there's a guy that sells near me. That's awesome. Way better than pitta bread. And I would always choose that. But I'm not writing off the pitta bread. You know, that's what I grew up. That's what I was having.
There's got to be an availability to the bread as well, though. You know, I don't doubt there's probably like magnificent breads that you can serve a kebab on, but. You know, the naan is worldwide, as is the pitta, right?
Let's ask Rich. What's world?
Maybe not worldwide, but country-wise.
This pitta bread, is it spelled P-I-T-A?
Yeah.
Okay, I call that pita bread for some reason. Yeah, I love that stuff. It's great.
You seen a naan? Lot of
it. Huh?
Have you seen a naan? Are you familiar with a naan?
N-A-A-N.
No, I don't know what that is.
It's like Indian cuisine.
Do you get... Do you eat kebabs?
Yes, I had. Well, when I was staying in the UK, I was having them all the time. They were really good. And yeah.
What about in the US? Because I had some kebabs in Texas. They were pretty good.
Sometimes.
Weren't quite up to the UK standard, but they were okay.
There's none. There's really none around where I live. I have to drive a little bit to get to one that sells them, but they're good. I like them. Do you guys have Mongolian beef barbecue?
No,
but it sounds amazing.
So good. They have these big, round, huge round, I guess, for lack of a better word, stoves. And you pick all your meats and you pick all your vegetables and everything. And you put it in a big bowl and then they dump it on this thing. And then they move it around with a stick and it cooks all up. And it's so good.
Really it sounds good. Like Brazilian barbecue. That's what, there's like a rise of Brazilian barbecue restaurants in this country. That's like it's just guys walking around with essentially a sword with barbecued meat on it, and they just cut a piece off for you, and they'll bring it to you as soon as and you know until you get the meat sweats and pass out.
Yeah. Oh yeah, there's a me and my buddies from The Mandalorian, we all had dinner at this Brazilian steakhouse, and that's how they did it. Oh, it was so good. All these different types of meats they would bring around. You could choose which one you wanted.
Mm, yeah, it's really good.
Oh, is that like the place where you got like the red card and the green card and they bring out?
Yeah, that's the idea. As soon as you turn it over to red, they won't bring any more. But if it's on green, they're bringing that meat to you.
You know, I get the appeal of that, but it just fills me with anxiety. That's why I won't go. Chloe tried to make me go once to a family meal, and as often as happened, I declined.
A family meal? Why? Because why?
Well,
why
that's my own issue with eating out, but we'll get to that another day.
let's open that door a little bit. Why is that? Because you feel like everyone else has turned over and you're still going? Or,
No. Because you know what I'm like, right? I'm very fussy. I like what I like. You know, I've got a very
clearly.
How would you put it? No, I don't not like pita bread, Gav. It's just not appropriate for the situation that we're discussing. But you know, I've got a very immature palate. You could say. I think that's part of what the difference is between me and you as well, Gav. You know, you're coming from a certain perspective. I won't call it the posh perspective, but some of
traveled,
us
traveled, I'd say.
Yeah, a couple of us are just, you know, a couple of regular working class Joes over in.
If your universe extends from Bolton to York, maybe you need to extend to it a little bit.
You're saying traveled, and then you're the guy who shut up a wall in a hotel.
It's a spectrum, man. It's a spectrum. I've dined with kings, literally, and also, you know.
What do you mean, literally?
I've eaten with royalty.
What?
Which one? Prince Andrew, was it?
Prince Andrew.
No, not quite. It's Spanish royalty, not quite English royalty, but yeah, I've dined with royalty.
Okay, I think we need to get into this end of the show. okay. I don't know where that came from.
Well, you call me posh. I thought I'd bring out my credentials.
And of course, you had to bring you back to feces. Oh dear!
You want to talk some shit?
Always and forever. Okay, we'll wrap it up there. Thanks for joining us again and listening to that diatribe on. That's like the word of the day today. On kebabs and naans and pitas and kebabs, whatever one of those is. Follow the show at UK Steelers Pod. Follow me at Cy Wrote This. Dave at This Is Dave Hart and Gav at GM Boom Op on Twitter. And follow Rich on Instagram at Stunt_Batman. And hopefully I'll be wrong and we'll see you at 3-0 next week.
Whoa.
Cheers, guys.
See you later.
See ya.
See ya.